Happy Monday, everyone. Welcome to, episode 22 of the Monday Meta.
Yes.
23. They start to blend. COVID time has no meaning, but here we are. Happy Monday. It's the Monday Meta. It's a tough Monday, Martin. We had a ban announcement today, and I think that a lot of people have been deflated by it. We're going to spend some time, maybe all of our time, talking about bans before we dive into that. Let me let you know a little bit about us. I am Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left at Mashi Scanlon on social media. He is the Hall of Famer and member of the MPL at Martin Yuza. Hopefully you're watching us live right now on twitch.tv/Martin Yuza. If you aren't, check us out. 12 p.m. noon Pacific on Mondays. We go live on Martin Stream. We've got questions. We've got people, all of you typing in right now. We see you. If you're listening to the podcast, then yeah, come check us out live. Drop some questions in. Martin's really, really good about answering questions. And then Martin, are you going to stay on after this or not?
I'm going to be honest with you. I have no desire to play Standard right now.
I hear you. Yeah. I hear you, man. Dude, draft Zendikar Rising. I love it. I'm telling you, I love it. All right. Well, this podcast and all of Martin's great, great content is brought to you by ChannelFireball.com. You can check out ChannelFireball.com right now for all your Zendikar Rising needs. There's a bunch of new cards, including Omnath, which we will spend a lot of time discussing on this week's episode, that you can get right now available for you on Channel Fireball. If you head over to Channel Fireball, use our code META, M-E-T-A. That helps sponsor our podcast. That helps sponsor this stream and all of Martin's great content. You can also read Martin's stuff on CFB Pro. And if you have not signed up for CFB Pro, definitely sign up and use that code META, M-E-T-A. Again, that helps support us, helps support Martin and all of his great content. And it's well worth the read. Just before we went live, Martin, I was talking to you and I was saying, I went and read your deck guide on Gruul in Standard, and I read it on Friday, and I was like, I'm going to build a Standard deck. I haven't played Standard in a bit, and for a while I was really deep into it. Remember when I was playing Cycling? And then I said to myself, no, Mosh, don't do it. The whole metagame could change on Monday. And so I didn't.
That's a great point that you're making, because my friends were also asking, like, which I played Standard. Like, I was thinking of crafting this Omnath deck. I was also telling them, just wait a week. They just announced that there's going to be a ban announcement. And then they told all the grand finals players that the deadline to submit decklists is going to be postponed by a few days or something. So clearly something was going to get banned. And my question is, why do you announce the announcement instead of just saying, like, hey, this is gonna get banned? Like, what's the reason to just wait a week? Like, nobody was interested in Standard in that period of time. Everybody was waiting with crafting their decks or something. So you just create this week of, like, I guess we're just gonna not really do anything.
This is the worst of both worlds, because there was this horrible buildup where it's like we had all these speculations, and of course I was predicting that Uro, Omnath, and Lucky Clover would get banned. What was your prediction, Martin?
I was saying that Uro was gonna get banned, and that I think they might do an errata on Omnath, saying that instead of the ability being a landfall, you're now only going to get to trigger it once you play, or it's going to be warded so that it's your first land, your second land, and third land in a turn. So you can't just go like Omnath, get the three triggers, then play like a Genesis Ultimatum, get a new Omnath into play, and then start triggering again with the new landfalls, because unfortunately that's how it works, which I think, this is what enables all the crazy combos. When you watch somebody stream and, like, all of a sudden it's turn four and that person has 50 lands in play and, like, 17 creatures or whatever. So the way it's worded, it's not exactly great. And I think it would still be a completely busted card, but I thought they might change it, because a lot of players actually think that's how it works. Like, you can only get three triggers out of as many Omnath as you can have. But the reality is that every new Omnath kind of, like, resets the count.
Yeah, you get three more bites at the apple with every Omnath. So, look, the long and the short of it is, obviously you can tell from what we're talking, from how we sound and what we're saying, Martin and I both got it wrong. Wizards announced today that the only card banned in Standard is Uro. And I think that most people, I would say, I would venture to guess, felt like Omnath should have been banned. And at the very least, something like Lotus Cobra as well as Uro should have gotten the axe. So here we are. It's Uro only. You're talking about, why do you make the announcement? And I was saying, I think it's doubly worse in this scenario because they made the announcement. And so then we had this whole week of buildup of speculation of, are they going to ban Omnath? Are they not? And then what started happening is everyone started having the conversation of how, well, we think it's only going to be Uro and Uro isn't enough. Yeah. Whereas I think if they never announced that and we just woke up this morning and Uro was banned, people would have been like, ah, you didn't do enough, but okay. Like, I think the buildup really, really hurt them here.
Yeah, I agree. And I also agree with the fact that if you wanted to have an enjoyable standard format, which it definitely should be right after you introduce a new set to standard, which it became legal last week or something. It's been 7 days or whatever. This is supposed to be the most exciting time. This is supposed to be time where you get to brew, where you get to try new decks. You're supposed to be trying these party decks. You're supposed to be figuring out how many colors exactly you want to play in these party decks. You're supposed to be trying this, like, you know, green-white counters deck or whatever. You're supposed to be trying new control decks. You're supposed to be trying new mid-range decks with a lot of double face cards. Like, this is the time of the year, you know, four times a year, three times a year, however many times they print a big new set into standard. This is where it's supposed to be the most exciting. And the format is solved in 3 days because you just literally read the card. You read the card Omnath and you're like, well, why would I play anything else? This is the most broken thing I've ever seen. And the rest of the cards in the deck, the deck just builds itself. You're just like, okay, well, what can I play? What else has Landfall? Oh, it's Lotus Cobra, and then I have Fabled Passage and Evolving Wilds. Sure, I'll just put it all together. Okay, what are the expensive cards? Ugin and Genesis Ultimatum. I guess I'll just play those, and then you have a deck. And if you just look at the deck doesn't really have any weaknesses. It's just like a bunch of... It's the thing right now with Standard is it's a bunch of... very good, or like a bunch of insane mid-range threats. Cards like Omnath, like, there's no reason to play anything else. If you just look at the card, the card does it all. Like, the only thing it's missing is, like, if it said it can be countered. Like, you're gonna yeah, stabilize against aggro because it's gonna give you life. You can gain a life a turn if you wait with the fetch land for your opponent's turn. You can get the first trigger twice. It's going to give you an extra card when you play it. So even if you play against a midrange deck or something with a lot of removal or a lot of answers, you're never down on cards. And the rest of the deck is like a bunch of powerful cards as well. Like, you can't really go wrong by playing Lotus Cobra, you know, Cultivate into Escape to the Wilds and then resolve Ugin or something. Like, the deck doesn't really have any weaknesses. So it doesn't really make any sense to play answers or anything.
If we just assume for a second, look, Omnath is off the menu. Sorry, Martin, can't ban Omnath. New mythic, new set, can't ban it. What could you have banned? What do you think could have been like, hey, okay, I get it. We can't ban Omnath. In that case, if you want to fix standard, you got to ban. What's on that list?
It would just be too many cards. I think Omnath is just a huge mistake. I don't understand how the card gets printed. Like, it's just so odd. Like, you play three games with it. It's like Oko. You play three games with the card and you're like, wow, this card's busted. Like, I'm just going to build my deck around this card. And yeah, luckily there is, you know, 50 other cards in standard that you can use to build around it. So if you wanted to get rid of the entire deck, you would have to get rid of both of the fetch lands, like Evolving Wilds and Fabled Passage.
And Fable Pass, yeah.
You would have to get rid of Lotus Cobra, Cultivate, like all the cards that, you know, allow you to make extra land drops, the Dryad, but there's just too many. Like, it's just everything in standard is just built to ramp. And the worst part is there's nothing for the aggro decks. Like, normally the way to beat a ramp deck or a deck with, you know, 7 mana cards, 8 mana cards, is to try to play an aggro deck, play a bunch of one drops, maybe have a Thoughtseize or something. Sure, I'm gonna discard your Wrath with my Agonizing Remorse, and I'm going to use my one drops, and I'm just going to run you over before you can cast your expensive cards. That's usually the way to do it, right? Then I have this one removal spell, one Murderous Rider to get rid of the 4/4 that you play, whatever, your Siege Rhino or something. But right now, like, there is not even a playable one drop. Like, it's just like, it's a one mana 2/2 that says when you attack with it, you lose the game. Then there is a one mana 0/1 where you have to make land drops, which is something you don't really want to have to do in aggro. And like, the only playable one drops are like Edgewall, Innkeeper, and Lovestruck Beast, but you have to go green. So you kind of have to play either red green with Embercleave, or you could play mono red. You can play Gruul or mono red because you also have Embercleave. I think the reason to play Monogreen or something, I like Scavenging Ooze before because Ooze was like a natural answer to Uro, but right now that Uro got banned, you're not really going to need to play Scavenging Ooze anymore, so it's going to be better to just play a bunch of hasty creatures and Embercleave.
Well, and I think what's curious here is Uro, in the Omnath deck, sure, Uro powered up Omnath, no question. No one's arguing that. But he was really plan B. It was really plan B. It wasn't even plan A. So you take the most dominant deck in the format, and instead of kind of attacking plan A of that deck, you've tried to remove plan B. There's many other plan Bs that can take its place, but plan A is still intact. And that's what's kind of wild here. Let me take this from a different angle. Let's assume, and I saw your tweet about the numbers and stuff like that, that this ban has an effect. I mean, is there a world where this is enough, in your opinion?
No. Just banning Uro or?
Just banning Uro.
No, absolutely not. Like, there's no reason. I mean, you guys are going to see it. The grand finals is in 2 weeks or less than 2 weeks, I think. It's like on the 10th of October or something like that.
Yeah, I think it's something like that.
So that's a format where the 32 players, they qualified through the Invitational and the Players Tour Finals. They're going to play, I believe it's like 1 day of Standard, 1 day of Historic, and then a Top 8. Unless something changes, which I don't really know how that would happen. Everybody's just going to play Omnath, whether it's 4-color, whether it's 5-color, whether it's Omnath in Adventures, which we're going to get to later. Everybody's just going to be playing Omnath, and the same is going to happen afterwards because I believe the MPL starts at the end of October. Like, there's going to be some kind of league play or something. I'm not exactly sure on the dates, but I think we're supposed to start playing around that time. What could happen is they could look at the data from the grand finals and they could say, all right, well, yeah, everybody is playing Omnath. What a shocker. Let's see if it's enough of time to give people to, you know, they have hopefully bought all the boxes and everything, and now we're going to ban it, and maybe it's going to change something, but I don't know.
So I just want to say this. I don't think sales are a huge part of this because Zendikar has been heavily allocated. So they've already sold, like, it's basically sold out. And it's not that the fact is everything's been allocated because they weren't able to print enough because of COVID. So I don't know how much of it. I mean, if to take seriously the idea that Omnath can't be banned because of sales, which I don't think that's what's at play right now necessarily, means that it's going to have to remain in the format for a long time for all the distribution chain to catch up and then those boxes to sell. And that's not like a 1 month thing. It's going to take longer than that.
But then why do you think they didn't ban it? What do you think the reason is? Like, do you honestly think they believe in what they're putting into this article? Like, it could be
an overall marketing for health of the game that they don't want to appear like okay, you know what, we made a huge mistake, but we don't want to admit it just yet because it's bad for the brand image. Because that's one view of it, right? You don't want to say that about your new set. Now, I don't agree with that. I think it's better to just say, hey, mea culpa, we made a mistake, and that's really good for brand image. That's really, because that says, hey, players, we get it. We made a mistake. We're going to retract. But I'm sure some people, I mean, you've met people like this who are like, no, I'm not going to admit the mistake yet. Even though I know it's a mistake, I'm not going to admit it yet because that puts a hit on my image. So maybe that's what's at play. I'm not sure. I truly don't know.
Yeah, I mean, like, I think consumer confidence is like, you know, as low as it has ever been anyways. So might as well just, you know, do it. But to be fair, it's true that to fix Standard and just like make it enjoyable again, you would probably have to ban like all these engines. Like, the problem is that there are so many cards that are engines on their own. Lucky Clover.
Yeah.
It's just like, yeah, you just build the deck around it. There's just like not a lot of creativity or anything. Mm-hmm. You know, Omnath is an engine on its own. It gives you life. It gives you mana. It draws you a card. So you just build that. You just build decks around these cards, and you would have to ban Clover. You would have to ban Omnath. You would probably have to ban Innkeeper. You would probably have to ban Escape to the Wild.
I don't think you don't have to ban Innkeeper. I think that if you don't have Clover, you don't have to ban Innkeeper, in my opinion.
Maybe
I think
not,
Innkeeper's a fine card if you don't. I mean, at a certain point, when you keep reaching down, you have to ask yourself, I mean, are you in a world where you have to ban Embercleave?
Yeah, I mean, maybe, you know, it would. Yeah, like I enjoyed Magic the most when there's decisions that matter, like within the game. Like we tweeted like a week ago, like I enjoy Magic the, or like something like that. I enjoy Magic the most when there is combat phase involved. Like you're supposed to make, you know, a good attack, a good double block. You're supposed to actually think about, all right, this is not supposed to attack. Maybe I'm gonna bluff something. Like this is where the decisions actually matter. And instead we're just playing like this kind of like bingo where you play this one busted card and it just snowballs, right? You play Omnath and it snowballs out of control and that's it. There are no decisions. And I really enjoyed Magic like back in the days when, you know, you were excited to get three card out of Factor Fiction or you flash back Call of the Herd. Like Call of the Herd was the best card in Standard. Just think about it. A 3 yeah, mana 3-3 that can be flashbacked for a 4 mana 3-3 was the best card, the most powerful card in all of Standard. How crazy is that? Just think about that. Like Fire Ice was a card, like you were really excited to get a 2/4/1 out of your Chainer's Edict. You played card like Repulse in the main deck because it bounced Call of the Herd and you still drew a card. Like this is where I enjoyed Magic the most, and there was like a lot of really small decisions. You know, you were really excited to get a 2/4/1. The cards weren't super busted or anything. Like you could play a little bit slower. You could play cards like Cunning Wish. You could play, you know, Factor Fiction.
That, there was an era where you played Call of the Herd in Extended. There was an Oath deck that ran Call of the Herd, right? Because it doesn't trigger your you don't stop on Call of the Herd. So like Call of the Herd at one point was just like, man, this card is so busted. Wow, this card's insane. And it's literally one green, two other sorcery, put a 3/3 elephant token maybe into play, flashback two green, two other, put a 3/3 elephant token into play. And that was the card that was like, man, this card is so good. What were they thinking printing this card? I mean, wow.
Yeah.
You know, we're far afield from that. It's a different game. And you know, that's okay. And I don't want to be too boomerish by saying, boy, those were the good old days of Magic. Like, we can have good standard formats with what we have here. I don't think it's out of reach, but it does. We have to make moves. You know, well, Wizards has to make moves to create those formats, create those interactions. And we know it's possible. I don't understand. I'm a little disheartened. Like, I'm going to be honest. This is a tough episode, and we talked about it before we went live. Like, it's disheartening. Like, I don't feel like playing standard. I'm gonna be drafting, and I will say this for R&D, and I don't know where the philosophical focus has changed with Standard and with Building Constructed. The last few limited sets have been A+. They've been wonderful. Like Zendikar Rising is a lot of fun. I'm enjoying that. I thought M21 was great. I enjoyed Ikoria. Amonkhet Remastered was unbelievable. So there, I don't know if there's just more focus going on in limited sets, but it's been really, really good recently.
I agree. You know? I agree with you. It's also what I've been seeing everywhere on Twitter or anywhere on the internet. It's 100% true what you're saying. Everybody has been giving them credit. Limited has been great. Like we're seeing more of Kicker, more of Cycling. We're seeing the double face cards. Like, this is exactly how you make, you know, a better limited format. But unfortunately, WotC isn't capitalizing on that because we're playing literally zero limited tournaments. There's no incentive. Like, there's not even any kind of, like, you know, maybe Twitch Rivals, maybe some kind of, like, WotC thing where they would say, like, all right, let's have all the, you know, MPL and Rival players stream some drafts. Let's, you know, play against each other, some kind of streamer showdown. I guess they have some of those. Some streamers are probably, I think I've seen some of that, but I haven't really been following Limited in the last, you know, since we started playing All Constructed. So unfortunately, I don't think they're really capitalizing on that, and it's unfortunate, but Constructed, you know, that's what sells packs, I think, and that's what needs to be kept in check as well. That's what needs to be balanced. And unfortunately, for some reason, that hasn't been working out in the last year or two. And yeah, we were talking about that before the show started, and like, what's the reason? Like, it feels like there's no way after 25 years of pretty much getting everything right? Like the Magic R&D team, the play design team, like, you know, Mark Rosewater, you know, Aaron Forsythe, like these people are responsible for the fact that Magic has been so successful for 27 years, right? I would say it's mostly all them. A lot of that was like the play the game, see the world, like, you know, play a PTQ, qualify, you know, for a PTQ
totally
in Hawaii. I think that was super successful. I think that was a great idea. I would say, like, despite some of OP's best efforts in the last couple of years, like, Magic is still a great, great game. But unfortunately, for some reason, the card design in the last year or two, like, something happened, right? And there's no way all of those people just started making mistakes, like, when they got everything, pretty much everything right for 25 years. So what happened? Like, were they just told, like, hey, we need to cater to different people instead of, you know, these two teams or however many people it is, instead of you guys, you know, making sure that Standard is perfectly balanced and so is Modern or Historic, we need you to start designing product for EDH players. We need you to start designing product for Commander players, for the casual players, because there is so many more of those than the people who actually play Modern or Standard. Is it possible that this is the answer?
That could be it, but look, Martin, in just over a month, on November 7th, I think, Commander Legends releases. So there are, they put those cards in the Commander sets, right? If that's what you think is at play, those cards should be bumped to the Commander sets. Now, the counterpoint to that is, yeah, but Mosh, Wizards may want Commander players to buy the new sets as well, not just Commander Legends. Okay, yeah. I buy that. I can see that, but... You know, I don't think so. I think somewhere there's been a philosophical change in what R&D is looking to make. Like this, you're right. They're way too good at their jobs to be making this mistake or to be making these changes without some, I think, very top-level philosophical change. Now, what it is, I don't know. I mean, my instinct is, on its surface, something like Omnath happens because they're trying to make creatures more playable, but what they've done the opposite, right? Because it's a very high-powered creature. Now, that doesn't work with cards like Oko or Fires or Team or Wreck, you know, but it does for Omnath, because Omnath is a creature. Okay, let me ask this then, Martin, because it is the Monday meta, and we want to give people some kind of advice rather than just wailing on this ban announcement. So, how do you what do we do in the Omnath mirror? What should we be playing? What should we be looking for? How do we, if Omnath's the best deck and we're all playing Omnath, how do we beat the mirror?
I think you play a bunch of Mystic Disputes in the sideboard. I've seen two interesting takes on Omnath. I'm gonna show the Omnath mill deck first. This is a deck from Dylan Dunnigan, I believe. Or maybe it was Peter Ingram. I'm not 100% sure. I think it was Dylan Dunnigan who won a PTQ this weekend, or he won the Star City Open, not 100% sure what was the tournament, but this was his version. I believe it was two people that both played it, and they only lost to each other in the mirror, like in the semifinals. And this deck is using Ruin Crab and Glass Pool Mimic, which is one of the double face cards that can be used as a land. And the fun part about this deck is it only uses one Uro. So yeah, you just ban Uro from the format. Well, what is it gonna do? What is it gonna do to this deck? Exactly nothing. You're just gonna replace the Uro with an extra copy of Dryad, or, you know, an extra Cultivate, or whatever else. Just whatever one card you can think of that finds you an extra land, or allows you an extra land drop, or maybe an extra land. Whatever it is, you just replace literally just one card, and that might be the best version of this deck in Standard right now. The reason for Ruin Crab is that basically, you know, half the cards in your deck say that you can make extra land drops. Mm-hmm. And so, you can very easily just mill your opponent on turn 4 or 5. So this is quite possibly the best version of this deck for the mirror. It might be a little softer to aggro. Like if somebody goes, you know, 2-2-3-3 questing Bees Embercleave or something, it might be a little too hard to defend from that. But I think for the mirror, this was probably the best version. Like, you see the three disputes in the sideboard. The milling part can get your opponent pretty well as well, especially when they are also drawing extra cards, searching for extra cards with Cultivate, with Fabled Passage, you know, Genesis Ultimatums, revealing more cards. Escape to the Wilds basically says draw 5, right? So actually milling your opponent seems like a pretty nice idea. And the second deck that I saw was this four color adventures deck, which I saw for the first time in the Japanese Red Bull Untapped qualifier that happened over the weekend. I believe it got second, and I was like, oh wow, look at this, like somebody just thought of adding white to the Teamer adventures deck. They added four Omnath because the card is busted, why not, and the mana allows for it very easily. You play Fabled Passage, you have some of the Triumphs, You have Beanstalk Giant to search the land, so the mana is no problem. You get to play Giant Killer, which is a way to answer your opponent's Omnath or some of these, you know, aggressive decks with Questing Beast or something. And you still get to play Lucky Clover and Innkeeper. So basically, instead of having two engines, you now have three because you also have Omnath. So this is quite possibly also maybe the best deck in Standard. Who knows? But if you're playing Omnath, I would strongly suggest playing either this version or Dylan's version that goes more for the mill effect.
Right, so Dylan's version is kind of the more what we'll call the quote-unquote traditional Omnath deck, but it does add Ruin Crab, which is one blue for a 0/3 crab. With landfall, whenever land enters the battlefield under your control, each opponent mills three cards. So you can see in the mirror match where you're drawing all of those extra cards how every land that you know you play and you're milling your opponent for three, it's going to catch up to them real, real quick. You also get Glasspool Mimic that Martin mentioned, which is a modal double-faced land. And you may have Glasspool Mimic enter the battlefield as a copy of a creature you control, except it's a shapeshifter rogue in addition to its other types. So you get more of whatever it is you're missing. And of course, the reason Martin highlights these is this deck from Dylan, one Uro, and then this Adventures deck, which basically just plops Omnath into a standard kind of Adventures deck. No Uro at all. You get Beanstalk Giant, which is awesome. You know, you still have your fetch lands, which is also awesome, but you know, you don't need to worry about losing Uro because Uro was never there to begin with. And you still get your Mystical Disputes in the sideboard. Red Cap Melee, you know, if you want. I think is there one Melee maybe in here to take out Uro as well. But what this is demonstrating, what both these decks demonstrate very, very well is highly successful decks that do utilize Omnath and abuse Omnath but don't rely on Uro very much, if at all. To get their wins.
I also really like how Omnath just fits into the curve perfectly. Like you have Innkeeper and Lovestruck Beast on one. Then on turn two you have Lucky Clover. Sometimes you play Fae of Wishes if you have Innkeeper on turn one and you need to find land. So you just play the Fairy as a 1/4 on turn two. Otherwise you just Bone Crusher Giant if they have a creature like Lotus Cobra. Turn three, that's where you play Lovestruck Beast. That's where you play the Bone Crusher Giant to draw a card off of your Innkeeper. Maybe you just play Brazen Borrower at the end of turn or you bound something. And then on turn four, Omnath fits exactly perfectly into the curve. Obviously, sometimes you can also just find the lands with Beanstalk Giant, develop your mana, start playing Escape to the Wilds to really go off. But Omnath, I think, is just a natural improvement for the deck. And there is really no reason why it shouldn't be playing four colors, because the mana in the deck has always been great, and I've never really had any mana problems when I played this.
Yeah, you know, it is crazy how Fae of Wishes can get you land now.
It's true. Yeah, that's one of the sideboard cards is Kazul's Fury, which is the three mana flink, but the backside of it is a tapped red mana. So yeah, you can find lands that way. I mean, I think even previously you could have found lands if you just put, you know, a Fabled Passage in your sideboard, or usually we just try to put a Castle Vantress in our sideboard.
Yeah.
But yeah, now you can actually have like a playable card and a land in one slot instead of having to fill one more with an actual land.
I love that you don't have to dilute anything. You just get it and you can either, you know, fling something or get the land you need. So I think that's interesting. I mean, say what you want about Omnath, the modal double face cards in general in Zendikar Rising are such a great R&D win, you know, that I do think they're awesome. I love drafting with them. I love seeing them show up and constructed. And we talked about this last week. We spent a long time on this last week. So all their applications are awesome. So, Martin, when do you start testing for the grand finales?
I'm not playing. So.
Oh, you're not?
I can just watch. No, it was a top 16 from both of the tournaments. So I'm just going to be rooting for, you know, I think Ivan Flock is playing.
Are you going to be helping people test?
Probably a little bit. I mean, I'm mostly excited because I don't have to play this myself. Like, obviously I would love to play in the grand finals because, you know, it's a high EV tournament, but like right now the idea of playing a bunch of Omnath mirrors.
Yeah.
Like the that's another thing. The fun part about Magic is also playing against a bunch of different decks. When I was testing for the Mythic Invitational, which was historic and it was a new format because they just added, you know, Emonkhet Remastered, they just added whatever other set happened before that. And it was really exciting because every match you would play against something different. You would play against blue-white auras. Next match would be mono-red goblins. You play against Sultai Ram, band control, blue-white control, mono-blue tempo, mono-red burn, you know, mono-red with creatures, Ragdos Sacrifice, Jund Sacrifice, you know, company decks, Bolas's Citadel decks. It would be literally 15 or 20 different decks, and every match would be something different. Sure, sometimes maybe goblins would be a little bit more popular, but the format wasn't solved yet, and everything sure. seemed playable. Literally every deck seemed playable. At some point we were thinking of playing Blue White Auras, then we were thinking of playing Mono Blue Tempo, then we were thinking of playing Gruul Aggro because Embercleave. We were thinking of playing company decks. We were thinking of playing blue white control. So like you could really tell like, okay, this is a good format. Like everything feels playable. But then as people solved mm-hmm. it, you know, somebody figured out, okay, I guess goblins is just the most consistent. It's really good at finding Muxus. So that's going to be one of the best decks. And then Jund Sacrifice also kind of just started being like, okay, this deck just does the most powerful things. It has company. It has the Ketoven interaction. And Sultai obviously had Uro. I was kind of hoping for Uro to get banned in all formats, by the way, which I think would have just helped also to enjoy other formats, because I haven't played Modern in like a year, but from what I've seen, it's just like all Uro plus all the cheap cards, you know, Mishra's Bauble, and just like filling your graveyard with fetch lands and everything. So bringing it back is super simple, and I wouldn't mind seeing it gone. But yeah, the point about just enjoying Magic is when people can play a bunch of different decks, and that includes you and your opponent. So not only you can change decks and just enjoy different strategies and, you know, try to brew a little bit, maybe, you know, play these control decks. Every form of Magic was possible. You could have played a control deck, you could have played an aggro deck, auras, you know, kind of some kind of boggles deck. Everything was possible. Right now, if you look in Standard, you look at any tournament, it's just like top four. Four times four color Omnath, top 16, 13 times four color Omnath, you know, one Team Red Venture, one Gruul Aggro, one Monoid or something. And the problem also with Omnath is that what I think, I haven't played Standard too much, but what I think is you can't really build a great control deck, first of all, because playing answers when the threats are too powerful just doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. Second of all, now you don't have Uro as your grow spiral slash finisher, so that's going to be something that's going to be really missing in your deck. And also people play Clover, so you can't really play cards like Elspeth Conqueror's Death and a bunch of counter spells like Essence Scatter when the opponent's just going to go turn to Clover, and at that point you just lose the game because everything they play gets copied twice, and you know you can't really get rid of the Clover either. So this has always been the problem for like blue-white control. So right now I don't really think you can build a good control deck. Like not only are you gonna miss Uro, but also Elspeth Conqueror's Death doesn't kill Clover, and you know, cards like Essence Scatter or three mana counters like Neutralize, they also don't really deal with Clover if your opponent just plays it on turn two. So yeah, I don't think you can really play a control deck. So it's just going to be all Omnath. Maybe it's going to be all four color adventures. But either way, like Omnath is going to be a four of in the deck, and there's just no reason to not play it in Standard. The mana base is easy to make, and that includes so many basics. Even like the deck doesn't even need to play a bunch of triumphs, where you would just say like, oh yeah, like every land you play comes into play tapped. Maybe you're going to have a slow draw every once in a while. No, it's all untapped lands, and the deck actually gets away with playing 15 basics or something. That's kind of crazy.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the real problem, right? Omnath, the reason Omnath's going off right now is because the mana fixing, it's too easy to cast her. She, you would normally think that a four-color creature would be tough to cast on curve, or, and in the case of Omnath, not only can you get her out on curve, you can get her out a turn early. You get, you know, Lotus Cobra, you get everything going. You'd be cooking quickly, so... Let's talk. Do you have any final thoughts on Standard? I wanted to ask you about Historic.
I don't really know how to fix Standard. I don't think it can be fixed. Like, you would have to ban so many cards that you would have to ban all these engines. You would have to ban Clover. You would have to ban Omnath.
You could ban those two, and I think that's a good start. I think what Standard looks like. If Omnath and Clover were out, what would Standard look like? Now, maybe Embercleave becomes like, okay, Mosh, too good. But I mean, if we're on the Monday meta complaining about how good Embercleave is, I think I'm much happier with where Standard's at. You know what I mean?
It's also true that like Embercleave, like you need to have a bunch of creatures in play. And historically speaking, that has never been a big problem to solve. Like you can play Storm's Wrath, you can play whatever kind of Wrath effects are there in Standard.
Sure.
Shattered the Sky, whatever.
There's
Gaia's Wrath rotated. Yeah. Like there's always ways to get rid of
creatures. There's Extinction Event.
Yes.
There's a new one that like exiles all cards converted mana cost 3 or less and in your graveyard gets everything. You know, there's ways you can do it.
Yes, exactly. Basically every color now has a sweeper. There's cards like Bonecrusher Giant, which is a 2/4/1. You know, there are ways to answer aggressive decks. So if Embercleave was the most powerful card in Standard, I don't think it would be a problem. Like there are ways to answer creatures. And I think there is a super powerful Planeswalker right now. That's also usually a problem when you have cards like Teferi and Nissa. Like you just build your deck around them, then you just protect your Planeswalkers and they just snowball. They just give you a free win sort
Omnath,
of.
Omnath is our Planeswalker. Mode 1 is gain 4 life. I mean, sure, she plays like a Planeswalker. You get all this stuff for free. You don't have to invest in it. You just put a land into play.
Is there a powerful Planeswalker in Standard?
Right now, the most powerful Planeswalker in Standard is Nissa?
The green-black one?
Or Ugin? Ugin. Is Ugin the most powerful Planeswalker in Standard?
Yeah. Ugin might be the most powerful Planeswalker. The Firefire Manashia, because that's just too slow. Like it makes 2/3s. Like that's if that was the power level of all Planeswalkers, I would be insanely happy. Because this is okay. Like if you want to play a Planeswalker, it gives you some kind of free advantage every turn. That's okay, but it only makes it 2/3. It's not like, you know, Teferi. It's gonna stop me from playing half of the spells in my deck, and it's gonna bounce, you know, my thing or whatever. If Ugin was one of the most you know powerful cards, I'm happy with that too because it costs 8 mana. Like don't make overpowered 3 and 4 mana Planeswalkers. This is fine. So right now, yeah, the Planeswalker problem is okay. So if you bank Clover and Omnath, what would Standard look like? What would the next best cards be? Probably Innkeeper, Embercleave. I can't really think of anything. Like if the best cards in Standard are like Questing Beast, then that's a great Standard format. There's so many removal spells.
When you're complaining about cards like, and I don't know if it was Pat Cox or Luis where it was like, you know, the format is good when Baneslayer Angel is good. When Baneslayer Angel is playable, that's a good format. And that's what we're talking about. In, you know, if we're on the Monday meta next week and we're complaining about Embercleave and Questing Beast and these cards being, oh my gosh, they're too good, we're one step away from that Call of the Herd, right? Where it's like, man, Call of the Herd's so good. Fact of Fiction's so good. I mean, I remember talking to my friends about how, God, Fact of Fiction's so busted. What were they thinking printing Fact of Fiction? And that's just not a thing anymore, right? So...
Yeah, but at least like you can easily answer these cards. You can answer Embercleave, you can answer Questing Beast because there's literally 50 cards in Standard or more that trade with them for less mana.
There's always going to be a best card in Standard. There's always going to be a set of cards that are really, really good, right? The nature of the game isn't that you do things and everything's flattened out. There's going to be different strategies. Hopefully they're not oppressive, but there are better strategies and there's better cards, whether they're Baneslayer Angel or Embercleave or Questing Beast, or whether they're Fires of Invention, Team of Reclamation, Wilderness Reclamation. Like, that's the difference, right? Is when we're talking about what those best cards are. And we just want to get to a point where, yes, it's an equipment that you can play at instant speed, or it's a 4-mana 4/4 that you can kill immediately. Like, those are cards that have very, very easy answers and that they come down. And yes, in the case of Embercleave, it can affect the board immediately, but you can also just kill the creature it's attached to.
Play a flame sweep or like play some kind of infest or something. And that's exactly the thing. These cards can be easily traded 1/1 and it's going to be a fair trade.
Yeah.
If you look at Omnath, if you look at Reclamation, if you look at Fires, these cards either come into play, they draw you a card, immediately give you some mana, or just like completely take over the game by just giving you 100 free mana or something, which is something that you don't really get to trade 1/1 with because you don't want to stack your deck with, you know, Disenchant or something, because that's not really what you can play in Standard these days. So yeah, the cards that you can trade with, you know, 1/1, that's okay. We're not going to complain about Embercleave being powerful because there's literally a million answers. The cards that are engines on their own, Omnath is going to give you a card. It's going to give you 4 more mana. Like, it literally replaces itself in the card department And it's also free. It doesn't even cost any mana because you're going to get the 4 mana back. Like, that's, like, you can't play 1-for-1 against these kind of cards because you're always going to end up one card behind and they play the spells for free. So this is the problem. Like, this is why you can't print cards this powerful, because nothing else is going to be playable, because these cards are just going to be way too powerful and everybody's going to build their decks around them.
Okay, so quickly, because Standard, I think we've talked Standard out. We're not happy with Standard. Historic. Have you been playing any Historic recently? Because at this point, it's like, if you're playing Constructed, I feel like play Historic. That's my advice to everyone.
I played a little bit. I played Gruul. Basically, I just added the Kazandu Mammoth into the Gruul deck, and I tried playing a couple of copies of Collected Company, although I liked Company as a sideboard card against the control decks with, like, Wrath effects, you know, with the Shadow of the Skies and with Wrath of God and whatever other Extinction things were they playing.
Sure.
I like playing Embercleave main, but the fact that the Mammoth is, like, four extra 3-drops in your deck without really having to cut any creatures to make room for Company, because you're replacing the lands, but you're also replacing some creatures, it's still going to give you a good number of hits. And the fact that you can hit a 3-3 in your Company that you can otherwise play as a land, I think is really good. And just the card on its own is also pretty good, because it's a good carrier for Embercleave. Like, sometimes you just play a land, you play Fabled Passage, you make it 7/7, you put Cleave on it, and, like, all of a sudden you're attack for 16, right? Yeah. And the other thing is the red-green pathway that also improved the deck's mana quite a bit. Like, previously you played Rootbound Crack in that slot, but that kind of sometimes struggled when you drew multiple Rootbound Cracks, or you wanted to play the new deserts, like having Ramunap Ruins in the deck, possibly having the green one as well. Like, that kind of like clashed with the Rootbound Cracks. So now you get to play 4 Stomping Grounds, 4 Pathways, and you get to play a bunch of deserts, and you may as well play, like, 1 or 2 copies of, or maybe more, but you have to be careful of the Rootbound Cracks. So your mana is a lot better. You have a bunch of untapped lands for turn one, Land War Elf and Pell Collector, so your mana's great, and your Collected Company improved, and your Embercleave is still great. So overall, I think Gruul got a huge improvement. And another deck that I was mostly watching rather than playing was, like, the new kind of, like, Death Shadow, like the Scourge of Conclaves, or
Skyclaves. Yeah, it's 1 black, 1 other for 3/1. Land, and then the kicker, I think the kicker on it is, like, 1 black, 2 other, so you can pay...
It's 5/5. The kicker's 5. It's 1 black and 4 other.
For the kicker alone? Or that's what you end up paying?
The kicker alone is 4 and black, so it's 5 mana. The card costs 1 and black, and it's an XX, where X is...
Oh, yeah, we're talking about different cards. That's my bad. I'm talking about the 3/1, that every time you play Landfall, you can recast from the graveyard if you want.
No. This is a Scourge of Conclaves or something, or Skyclaves.
My bad. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Chat got it right. Thank you, Chat.
Scourge of the Skyclaves. Yeah, that's the card. It's kind of like a new Death Shadow. Its power and toughness are each equal to 20 minus the highest life total among players. So the idea is you're taking damage from your lands because you're playing cards like Blood Crypt, plus you're playing the new double face lands, like the mythic ones where you have to pay 3 life if you want to put them into play untapped, so you're quite capable of lowering your own life total, and obviously you're pressuring your opponent because, you know, you have a lot of 1-drops. You get to play, you know, if you play red black, you get to play Knight of the Avon Legion, you have Soul Scar Mage, so there's a lot of good 1-drops in Historic, so you're pretty fast, and then you have a 2-mana, like 5/5, sometimes a 2-mana 10/10. It's at its best against slower decks. So if you're playing against, you know, control or something where you don't mind taking 10 damage, then this card really, really shines. Plus, obviously, you also have Thoughtseize. So sometimes you just go to one Blood Crypt Thoughtseize, all of a sudden you're at 16. So getting yourself and your opponent to lower life total is not the hardest thing to do.
I love suicide strategies. All the way back to the days of Hatred. I love suicide black strategies, so that's always something that I've been into. Have you played any with the that God deck is that stuck or not? Because I've always been curious about it. I don't know why. I just keep going back and looking at that list.
Which deck?
The God Pharaoh's Gift deck, the mono black God Pharaoh's Gift.
I really liked what the group around Metnaz and Siggy and PV did with the deck for the Mythic Invitational. It looks like the deck is just a bunch of four offs and like 16 swamps, 4 castles and 4 towers. Mm-hmm. But I like that they're playing 4 Chupacabras, because I think that makes a lot of sense, and it solves a lot of problems. Like previously, it killed like Mayhem Devil and some of the sacrifice creatures from the Junt Sacrifice deck. It can also kill like a Skirk Prospector or like something from Goblins that's not going to allow them to just like play Muxes next turn. You have Phyrexian Tower, so sometimes you can play Chupacabra on turn 3 without any problems. And just like overall, I felt like having 4 Chupacabras just made the deck a lot better. So I've played a little bit with it. I've played a little bit with their version, and I liked how they improved it. One thing that also happened with Historic is now you get to play Feed the Swarm, which is 1 black sorcery. You get to kill Leyline of the Void, which was previously an answer for, you know, these.
Heck yeah! Kill that enchantment
for these.
You want Leyline? Yeah. For these, get decks. That Leyline out of there.
It's a good sideboard card for the Gift deck. It's a good sideboard card for the Red Black Lures deck that Salvato played in the PT finals, for example. So yeah, there's a lot of new like answers for some of the problematic cards for these decks. But obviously, you still have a problem of like, sure, I can answer an enchantment. What if they have Gravedigger's Cage, right? So this doesn't matter for Gift, but for the Lures deck, it's obviously a problem. But that gets solved if you're playing a tournament that has deck lists.
Open deck lists. Yeah. All right, Martin, should we give away a membership to CFB Pro?
Yeah, let's do that. Also, I've been watching Nassif stream, and he was streaming Historic, and he was streaming with Omnath. And
oh god, don't say that.
It was basically the standard deck. Plus, I don't even know which Historic cards he played. Like maybe some Shocklands. It was basically standard legal, and he finished the stream when he was ranked number 5 on the ladder, and he has been just winning every match. But obviously, it's a new format; people still haven't completely, you know, figured it out or whatever.
Jeez, but he was number 5.
Yeah, you guys should check out. I'm pretty sure he probably made it into a video on CFB, so you should check out the website. Maybe he wrote an article about it. I'm not exactly sure, but you can also check out his stream, Yellow Hat. On Twitch.
Yeah, twitch.tv/yellow hat. It's gonna be awesome.
It's gonna be one of the VODs. And the deck looked good, and like he didn't really spend like 20 hours on it. He was just like, I'll just try this. Maybe it's gonna be great. And then just like 3 hours later, he's just like, oh, I guess I'm number 5 on the ladder now. And the deck's working out, and you know, there's obviously a lot of room for improvement. And,
Martin, you're recommending Omnath in Historic? Is that what you're doing?
So my first thought was that Omnath is going to replace, basically, it's the 4-color ramp is going to replace Sultai, because I didn't like how Sultai played too reactive. I like Thoughtseize, I like Uro. These cards go together, sure, that's all great. But I don't really want to play cards like Heartless Act, Eliminate. I don't want to play Agonizing Remorse or Thought Erasure or whatever. And Omnath is just like a bunch of proactive cards instead of playing reactive. So I think it would make a lot of sense to just start playing that instead of Sultai, even though you're gonna lose access to Thoughtseize, but I think it's worth it.
The only reason I brought up his Historic is so we could get away from Omnath.
Yeah.
What do? You close the episode by saying, hey, try Omnath and Historic. How could you do that? How could you do that to us, Martin?
Yeah, sorry to disappoint you, but I think we're gonna start seeing Omnath in other formats as well. Like if you look at Modern, like you get to play a bunch of fetch lands. So you have all these, you know, Misty Rainforests and Verdant Catacombs and whatever you need to ensure that you get all the landfall triggers. So you can also pitch it to Force of Will if you want to play it in Legacy. I think we're going to start seeing Omnath in every format the same way we saw Oko kind of started dominating every format. Even though this is a 4-color card, man. It's a creature, it's a lot easier to answer, but I'm pretty sure that's what's going to happen. All right, winner.
UMR underscore convert Covert Man. Umer_covert man. If you can send a whisper to Martin, he can get you all set up for your free CFB Pro. That does it for this week's Monday Meta. I know it's a bit of a downer. I think that Martin and I are both a bit disappointed.
We're just, to put it lightly. We're just being realistic. Like, I don't want to hate on Standard. I want to play Standard. I don't want to like go and watch somebody stream Among Us. I want to play Standard. I want to watch people stream Standard. I want to watch people stream Historic, and I want to be excited about these new decks. But it's just impossible right now. Like, I wish I could do it. But, I mean, I don't want to hate on these things, but that's just how it is right now. What I think is that they, instead of, you know, banning a bunch of cards, they said, like, okay, let's just try banning Uro. Let's see if that's going to fix the format. We all know it will not. So they're going to give it 2 more weeks or something. The Grand Finals is going to be all Omnath. And then after the Grand Finals, they're probably going to say, okay, so now that we have the data, we see that Omnath is really dominating, and maybe we're going to take some action. That's what I think is going to happen.
So we'll end on this then.
Sorry.
Will Omnath be legal in Standard
by the
November 1st?
Yeah. I'm going to say no.
No. Okay. I so you got the under on November 1st. That might be too bad a line. Let's see. I'm going to say over under October 23rd.
Friday. I would have to check when the MPL play starts, because I'm...
That's a good question.
I don't remember the numbers, but yeah, I would have to check exactly when the MPL play starts. I can't imagine them banning anything like 3 days before that, although it's definitely in their range. It's more likely it would happen the week after or like 2 weeks before or something to give us a little bit of time. I am actually fairly convinced that I think there is a strong probability that it can just happen after the Grand Finals to just, you know, say like, okay, well, this format is not really diverse or
just put it to
anything.
Rest.
Yeah, and like we're gonna change that a little bit and see what, you know, the MPL and Rivals people come up with when they play against each other.
I'm with you. Well, that does it for this week's Monday Meta. Hopefully, we're going to have to figure out, maybe we just got to play Historic this week or something. No Omnath, Martin. I don't want any more Omnath talk, because we got another week and this format's not going to change. I don't think there's going to be another ban announcement between now and then. So we got to figure out what we're going to do. But that is this week's Monday Meta. Like I said, a bit disheartening with the ban announcement. We did Uro, I think, was a step in the right direction, but sometimes a half step just doesn't feel as good as a full step, because you feel like that's all you're going to get. You're going to get that half measure, not the full measure. There's still time. We don't know. There have been emergency bans in the past. I don't know if that's going to happen here, but we'll see. And we'll all be watching together. Thank you so much for hanging out with us. If you're hanging out with us live, we appreciate you. Twitch.tv/MartinYuza. If you're listening to the podcast, hit subscribe. If you go to channelfireball.com, buy something or join CFB Pro, make sure you use that code META, M-E-T-A. That supports this podcast and all of Martin's amazing content. Until next week, I am Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left, at Mashi Scanlon across all social media platforms. He is the Hall of Famer and member of the MPL, Martin Yuza, at Martin Yuza. You can find him on twitch.tv/MartinYuza. We'll be back next week, 12 noon, on twitch.tv/MartinYuza for more of the Monday Meta. Until then, be wonderful to yourselves. Be wonderful to each other. Thank you.
Thanks for watching. See you guys next week.
Take care, everyone. Yeah. See you next week.